Today, it's not unusual if an audit takes place, and there are many more audits right now, and there will be probably for about a five-year period, that the baseline documentation is also being required, that be sent into the IRS. So years ago, I think a lot of the smaller land trusts weren't as diligent about this, and I know that now New Hampshire land trusts are paying an awful lot of attention to these kind of details, and it's really good that they are. The ship's been tightened up, and it's in many ways been good. Well, we often say that conservation easements are flexible documents that can be written to meet the landowner and the land's needs. And I always like to cover the issue about what if you want to keep a little bit of an area out for either a couple of lots for the kids or the potential for selling off lots in the future. And very often I work with folks that want to do that. And on this map here, I've given an example of a property with a couple of existing buildings. And this family decided that they wanted to keep enough area out for two additional house lots. This is often done and can be done. And it can be done in a couple of ways, which show you the flexibility of how easements can be done. The traditional way is that you survey this unrestricted area around the buildings. Typically today, most of the easements that we do the existing buildings in that way. We used to, back in the 70s and 80s, restrict the whole thing. And then anytime someone needed to come in for an addition or a new septic system or a new well, they had to go to the land trust or the holder of the easement and make sure that that was all approved in advance. We quickly learned that that was a zone we didn't want to have anything to do with. So now we leave that, in most cases, as an unrestricted area. Well, there's another tool that we can use in conservation easements if we want to do this kind of thing and a lot of other creative things, called a section that we call the reserved rights section. And in that section, you might state, I, the landowner, want to reserve the right to create two additional house lots at some point in the future in Antrim based on the zoning and subdivision laws of Antrim at that point in time. And I know that it requires the approval of the conservation organization that's holding the easement and all that. Well, there are a couple of advantages to doing it that way. One is that we can restrict the entire thing, and even this area where the house lots might be constructed or taken out eventually. And if those landowners never do that, then we've restricted more property and perhaps added more conservation value to what's been restricted. And some of the conservation organizations like it because they can also put a little additional language in there saying, okay, we'll let you do it this way, but that right is only going to be yours. It's not going to get passed on to the next landowner. So it's sort of a term. It has a lifespan to it, and it won't live on forever as the easement does. Okay, some other features. I mentioned already that development rights are actually extinguished. One of the things that our public officials love related to conservation easements are that privately owned property remains in private ownership, and of course it stays on the tax rolls, as we've said before. That's something our public officials love to quote. We often today are doing easements on publicly owned land, and I'm doing a lot of work in towns in my area that are looking at the pressures on town-owned properties and making hard decisions about portions of those properties or entire lots that they want to conserve with conservation easements, thinking about what the population pressures are going to be in 5, 10, 15 years, and you know the demand for things like fire stations and all that, the soccer fields and all that that are already going on down my way. I'm sure they are here too. We've already mentioned the encouragement of continued forest and farm management of properties. And by the way, New Hampshire has also been a leader in writing conservation easements that, if appropriate, allow withdrawal of water for public water supply. There's a great deal of state right now that's in a really serious water shortage, at least it will be in the next 5, 10, or 15 year period. There are a number of communities around the state looking for water and in a situation where they can't find enough potable water within their boundaries. They're looking in communities around them. I don't think a lot of us that have lived here for a long time ever predicted that New Hampshire would be in that situation with drinking water, but it's the case. So we can write easements in such a way that public water supply can be placed on the property and water withdrawn on a sustainable basis. I think New Hampshire's been a leader in that. Well, we sometimes today, and very often actually, write easements with two easement holders, sometimes more than that. But this gets at that issue about what if you're concerned about the first land trust going out of business, do you want to know who that second one is going to be there to catch the easement, to take on the responsibility if they do go out of business? And that's one of the reasons that we do this. We set up a tier. Typically, the way we do it is we set up a tiered arrangement where there's a primary holder and a backup or executory interest holder. The job of the primary holder is to do the baseline documentation, the annual monitoring, all that, all the grunt work, basically, and to send a report to the backup interest holder. Backup interest holder's job is to make sure that the first party is doing their job, and they actually have the authority, if they need to take over the responsibility of the easement if that isn't going on. They recognize there are problems that need to be addressed and the first party isn't. So setting things up this way can be healthy and is very often done today. There are reasons sometimes with funding sources that require this as well. So we often are in an arrangement where we're setting up complicated interest holding patterns today. Easements have been tested in a lot of states, have been tested in New Hampshire a number of times, have held up very well, and we all keep our fingers crossed that that'll continue to be the case. I'm going to talk about tax advantages of gifting and selling. So you can have the value of conservation easements or development rights, it's the same thing. You can have the development rights of your property appraised, and that value can be used as a gift to and you can claim an income tax deduction from it, or if you're lucky, we can try to sell some portion of the value of it. So there may be tied in with it some significant income tax and some less significant today, but perhaps for some folks, significant estate planning benefits that we'll chat about. Just a couple of notes on selling. If you're considering that, we always work with qualified appraisers and qualified appraisals. The numbers, the values that we come up with for development rights or fee acquisitions are arrived at through qualified appraisals, not the assessment that the town's got on your property, not a drive-by realtor's appraisal. It's a much more complicated, unfortunately much more expensive appraisal process. The local land trust that you work with keep a list of the qualified appraisers that work in this area. There really aren't that many of them statewide that do this. They're qualified because of IRS qualifications. There are different levels of appraisals, different standards that they have to meet. All the funding sources require this, and if you haven't heard, you know, conservation funds, state of New Hampshire, like most fundings, are relatively scarce, though we hope that the playing field changes a little bit better this year. So I like to talk to folks about bargain sales and how they work. I'll give you an example of that in a minute. But bargain sales are where if you have an appraised value, you're selling it for less than its appraised value. The difference between the appraised value and what you actually sell it for is considered a gift. The trick about why conservation easement appraisals are expensive is you're really getting two appraisals in one. And what they talk about is doing a before appraisal, which is the fair market value of the property, and an after appraisal. The after appraisal is really what's this property worth after you do the restrictions on it. You still probably own the timber, the right to farm it. You've got some underlying land value there. What's that after value going to be? And the development rights are basically the difference between the two, with other things taken into account. So it's really two appraisals in one, which is part of the reason that you're dealing with a much higher expense than a typical appraisal. Okay, bargain sales. I mentioned it's really the difference between that appraised value and what you agree to sell it for, and the deduction. The deductions we'll talk about how you can use this as an income tax deduction in a minute. But you can often combine this with savings that you're taking from the capital gains tax. Unfortunately, when you're selling development rights, even though you're not selling the property, the capital gains tax applies. So we've still got a 15%, potentially anyway, a 15% capital gains tax that we're dealing with there. And very often, if we're not selling the property, we don't have the realtor's fees to worry about. So one of the savings on this end of it are those two things combined. Could be as much as 23% that you're saving it, as opposed to going a traditional route. We can stretch dollars significantly by using bargain sales, and we very often try to encourage landowners to do that. And sometimes it works out with a bargain sale that what ends up in their pocket is just about the same for some folks anyway. Here's an example right out of the booklet that you've got. Sale price, appraised value of $100,000. They actually sold it for $85,000, so the difference here was that $15,000, not perhaps real world values, but at least for the area that I work in, it's not real world values anymore. It goes down through the scenario and the differences between realtor's fees and no realtor's fees and the capital gains tax comparison between the two sales. And you can see that the net value to the landowner really isn't that different. Now, what about this income tax deduction? How does this work? Well, until last year, we had a deduction that really wasn't that great. And we're really excited that the law has changed and changed for the benefit of all of us. It's been a big deal, and it's really changed the amount of work that I've been doing in the last year. So up until last year, if you gave away $100,000 in property value for conservation purposes, you could deduct 100% of that $100,000. However, you are capped each year that you are claiming the deduction to 30% of your adjusted gross income, and you had a 6-year period to claim the deduction, okay? So the year of the gift and a 5-year carry forward, 30% of your adjusted gross income each year. The new income tax deduction rules are quite a bit different. Now we can deduct up to 50% of our adjusted gross income, and we've got a 16-year period, the year of the gift, and a 15-year carry forward. And that has really helped, particularly New Hampshire landowners that have greatly appreciated property and not necessarily the income to match the appreciated property. We needed that stretched out time to be able to claim the deduction. It's really helped a lot of folks. There's a further part of this new rule that's interesting, and it doesn't apply all that much to New Hampshire, but for farmers and folks that earn at least 50% plus of their income from their woodlots the year that they're making this gift, they get to deduct up to 100% of their adjusted gross income, and they get a lifetime carry forward. So Congress was lobbied successfully enough to recognize that folks that are still farming and getting timber products from their property and ranching in the West aren't the highest income earners often in those regions, and they need a better income tax deduction than the regular folks. So this is basically how it worked out. There are some wrinkles with it, and I've got some examples. Yeah, Karen.
Question, is that change just for conservation, gifting conservation easements, or is it also for gifting land?
It's a good question. One of the wrinkles with the new law is that the new law only applies to gifts of conservation easements, and I think it was a flat-out mistake. I hope that they correct it. There is already a new bill before Congress to make this permanent. The law only applies, the one we're working under right now, to 2006 and 2007. So if folks are interested in taking advantage of this and knowing that they're going to be able to get these kind of deductions, you've got this year to finish the transaction. However, after the election in November, we anticipated that there might be a move to make this more permanent. It came along a little bit more quickly, I think, than some of us thought. So there is a bill in Congress right now to make this permanent. We'll see what wrinkles are with that one. I'm not quite sure how that's going to work. But the rules that we live under right now, the new deductions are for gifts of conservation easements. It's strange because a gift of property, you would think, why wouldn't, that's more of a gift. So we're often recommending to folks, give away a conservation easement first. You get the bigger deduction, and then gift the property away, and you get a double layer of protection anyway, if that's an issue. So here's an example of the old rules and how a gift of $100,000 in property with a $60,000 income would work over a 6-year period. And this example is in your book, the Conservation Options book. And you see, it's $60,000. You can deduct each year out of that $100,000 gift 30% of your adjusted gross income. So 30% of 60 is $18,000. So in the after the first year, you've got 82 left of the 100. And you just keep, if your income level stays the same, which it never does, of course, but if it does, you just keep chipping away at that $100,000 gift. $18,000 a year gets chipped out of it until year six, where you have just $10,000 left in it, and you finally deducted the full $100,000. It's not a tax credit, unfortunately, it's a deduction. The actual tax savings are calculated on the right-hand side. So in this case, $25,000 in tax savings on a $100,000 gift, $60,000 a year income. Now, new rules. I cracked this out with the same income, but I upped it to a $400,000 gift. I think a more significant, a more realistic gift, often with the property values I'm looking at today. So now, $60,000 a year, we can deduct up to 50% of our adjusted gross income. So it's $30,000 a year that we're chipping out of that $400,000. And you work down through this, it takes two pages to do it now. And we don't even have to go to the full 14th year for a $400,000 gift with $60,000 a year income. We've deducted the whole thing at the end of year 13, and tax savings cranked up quite a bit, almost twice. It's much more than twice. What was it? $25,000? I forget. So $92,500 for this. But of course, it was a much bigger gift. Okay, let's cover just a few things on estate tax and what we need to think about and how this may tie into that. I find this first statement, the general rule statement, to be a surprise to some folks, but when you die and pass stuff down to your heirs, if you've ever been through an estate settlement, you know that everything is appraised. So it's everything that gets transferred, even insurance policies, all that wealth is are taxable assets. When they get passed down to the next generation, if they're at a certain level, above $2 million this year, every dollar above that gets taxed. It's due to the IRS in 9 months, and they want cash, not property. It's an important thing to remember, and that's why 15, 20 years ago when I first started doing this, we were in a mad scramble to try to get folks